How many times have you guys heard, in all God's timing, everything works out, right? One of the most biggest frustrating things for me to ever hear in my life. I'm an entrepreneur, I was in sports, I was in the military. If I want success, it gets done now. But when you read Ecclesiastes chapter 3, the richest and wisest king, King Solomon, says, everything is based on God's timing. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 through 8, let's unpack what King Solomon says is the importance of God's timing. There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, and a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and time to gather them, and a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, and a time to be silent and a time to speak, and a time to love and a time to hate, and a time of war and a time for peace. So, how many different polar opposites does King Solomon have to share with us? I mean, for those of you that went into Proverbs, Proverbs is exactly like this. There's some opposites that King Solomon likes to teach us. Things here and things here, they're completely opposite. So I see seven stages here. When we're looking at a time for everything, I see seven stages of life when he's describing this. Let me unpack that. Well, the first stages of life is the first one. He says there's life and then there's death. There's planting and then there's reaping. So how I look at this thing is, you know, oftentimes we want to start a business, we want to start a career, we want to start saving money, plan for retirement, we want to create generational wealth. We want success now. We see what's going on in social media, say, hey, they're having success. Hey, they're having a lot of people at their event. They got a lot of money here, but you don't know the timing behind when they were actually prayerful about when things were set in motion. And the sad part about this is this first stage, we play the comparison game. And instead of you playing the comparison game, you need to play the trust game, which is what? Trust God. Trust in timing. Now, I've been around the business world for a minute, and I've seen guys accelerate in their business in their 60s. I've seen guys accelerate the business at 8, 9, 10 years old. I've seen people have success, fame, and fortune, and have celebrity status early on in their life, and I've seen the same opposite happen with people in their 40s, 50s, and 60s. So when I was growing up, I was watching a show called Different Strokes. What you talking about, Willis? Right? Gary Coleman, childhood actor, had success early in his life. But then the opposite is true when I watch movies like X-Men. You find guys like Ian McKellen, who's discovered playing movies is older in life as Magneto, and he's, you know, he's playing Lord of the Rings, and he's got this massive acting career, but 60, 70 years old, now he gets success. So what's this all about? Everybody's got a different track. You've got a different track, but you got to just trust God's timing. We continue the other stages of life that is discussed here in Ecclesiastes 1 through 8. King Solomon talks about killing and healing and breaking down and then building up. And I think to myself also, wait a minute, isn't one of the first commandments thou shalt not kill? And I actually unpack that word, and it actually has a deeper meaning. It says thou shalt not murder. Because listen, I'm served in the Marine Corps, and listen, if somebody attacks your family, what are you going to do to defend your family? And in that process of defending your family, what happens if you kill that person? I'm not telling you to go kill that person, but when that situation in life happens, then what? Then there's healing. There's healing from that moment. So all, again, God's timing here is showing it. So as we continue to dive into this thing, you can see how God is working through these different stages of life, which brings us into the third stage, which is weeping and laughing and then mourning and then dancing. So how many times have you been in a situation where you had a party, success, excitement, hit a goal, next you know, sadly somebody passes away. And the person who had that milestone crossed in their life, now instead of going through their wedding, now they go to the burial. Somebody said something very interesting to me. It says, the man in a wedding in his black suit has the same attire when he gets buried. Because when a man gets married, timing for everything, that means the man dies to his old self, his former self, and now is rebirthed into his new self.
There's a reason why the dress for the man is the same at a wedding and a funeral. Because you're saying goodbye to your previous self. The woman is the icon, the symbol of beauty, almost always in all white, right? Ascendant. The man is usually in black and white, like he's attending somebody's death, because it is his death. No, but think about it. It's the death of the bachelor mindset. It's the death of promiscuity. It's the death of the wandering eye. It's the death of immoral behavior. It's the death of texting girls casually. It's the death of I get to do what I want to do. It's the death of just going to the bar with friends. It's the death of acting like an infant. It's the death of playing video games till 1 a.m.
Same thing happens to you here on earth. You die to your old self, your life, so now you get to experience, in Jesus' name, eternal life.
Number four, throwing away stones and gathering stones and embracing and refraining from embracing.
Fifth stage here discussed is seeking and losing, keeping and throwing away. How many times have you experienced moving, packing all this stuff? Now you realize I've hoarded so many different things and I got to get rid of things. I got to purge things that are not useful to me in my life any longer. Maybe that's also an evaluation of friends, an association, and even potentially even family members that aren't serving you today in the goal that God has placed you on, the purpose that He's got you on for the remainder of your life. Maybe that's an assessment of the time is now to make that tough decision. Sixth stage of life discussed here, which is tearing and sowing, silence and then speaking. So God gave us two ears, two eyes, one mouth. There's stages in a dialogue, debate, conversation to improve your life, to avoid conflict, to resolve conflict, to make sure that you stay on point for what God has purposed for you in your life. So there's a phase there of you having to tear things down or build things up, and certain phase there which you got to shut up and listen, so therefore you both can come together with a viable solution to whatever it is that you're facing. Which leads us to the seventh phase, which is love and hate, war, and then peace. And I pray that you have more peace in your life than war. But however, at times, what does it say? Sometimes in order to have peace, you gotta go through war. Sometimes in order to have love, you also have to have, sadly, hate. In that process, God's going to reveal to you how much you need to depend more on Him than you need to rest on your own I got me type attitude. My second biggest takeaway from Ecclesiastes in this chapter, he says that there's nothing better in life than to be happy. Don't you want to be happy? Some days you just don't feel that you've got to win. And the weight of the world is on your shoulders. I've been there, done that, experienced that many, many times, and will continue to experience that many, many times. The big difference though is whose trust and strength and love do you rest on? Is it just you, your wife's being, just your family's being, or is it an eternal being? If we go back to Ecclesiastes chapter 1, what? You got to look at things from an eternal perspective. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 12 to 13 says this: I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is a gift of God. Which leads me into my third takeaway here from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. There's nothing better than for you to enjoy your work. Yes, work. And by the way, I get to be an entrepreneur. I don't have to be an entrepreneur. And I pray that for many of you, that you find yourself in that very position. I get to be a dad. I get to be an entrepreneur. I get to be in this gym and work out and have the opportunity to better my temple of God, which is my physical body. I hope that you feel that way of everything that God places in your life, that you don't have to do it, you get to do it. You know, if you look at the timeline of your life, the timeline from you being born to 18 years old, okay, a lot of riffraff there, but for the most part, you leaned a lot on parents, you leaned a lot on your support structure at that point. But from 18 all the way to 65, 70 years old, that's called working years. Your peak earning years are between those times. 18 to 65, 70 years old, somewhere in there, you find your career, you find your business, you discover relationships, you learn how to become a productive citizen, you're contributing to society, you're contributing to your family, you're making money, you're buying a house, putting your kids in school. But here's the thing. This right here, between 18 and 65 years old, I pray, according to King Solomon's word here in Ecclesiastes, that you find something that you love to do, that you love your work. And so when you see so many people today in America living paycheck to paycheck, they're struggling with their business, they're having jobs that they don't really like, they just took it because it pays the bills. You have a choice to pray up and say, hey God, what is the timing in all this? If I don't love my work, I pray that you put me in an opportunity that opens up a door for me to be happy, not only financially for what it pays me, but the impact that I make in society. That my business is used, not by me, but more so by you, God, to make an impact and a difference in people's lives. So yes, there is a timing for you to be starting off, planting, and then to be reaping, not just your revenue, but reap souls for Christ, because your net, your business, captures many people's attention based on how you're living your life, based on the fruit of your labor, based on the evidence of success with the people around you and the products and services that you offer, the people that work together with you and for you, the vendors that do business with you too as well. Everybody's prospering because you are prospering. And guess what? You're happy with whatever is going on. Now, I'm not saying that there's not gonna be enough stress. Of course, it's gonna be stress. It could be issues, there's gonna be problems. But at the end of the day, you look back and say, man, I love what I do. I get to do this. I want to do this. Lord, give me more. That's what King Solomon is trying to get you to look at. Look at things from an eternal perspective. Because here's the thing, at 65 years old or 70 years old, whenever you decide to retire, hang it up and call it quits, you look back on your life and say, man, what do I have to show for? Or what do I have to owe for? Which reality do you want at 65, 70 years old? The choice is yours. But God says, listen, rest on me. Trust me. I've got you. This is my timing. Whether I get you to succeed in your 20s and 30s or get you to succeed in your 40s, 50s, and 60s, it is my timing. Because if it was on your timing, guess what? Guess who's God? You. You become God. Versus saying, no, I'm going to trust God to be God, to do his job. I'm going to do my part to serve him, honor him, love him. And God's going to do his part. So you know what? My son, my daughter, I got to bless them to find something that they love to do. Whatever it is. Like, listen, in a million years, I never thought I'd be in the insurance business. Never thought in a million years I'd be an entrepreneur. I could barely even spell the word entrepreneur until about 5-6 years ago. But I found something I love to do. I thought I loved being a United States Marine. I thought I would love being an athlete. I thought I would love going out and making a living, traveling the world. Nope, it's not the way it's supposed to be. God's timing got me interrupted to have a guy have an interaction with me, you know, some of the weirdest places in the world. And in one case, I had a God moment in the bathroom of a Best Buy. And that conversation absolutely changed my life. Things don't happen to you. Things happen for you. Why? It's God's time. Certain things happened to me in December 2014. My life collapsed. I saw my wife crying on the couch. Things that we had worked for got taken away from me. I said, Lord, what are you doing here? What are you closing? What are you opening? Next thing you know, I sent a couple messages, did a couple phone calls, have a couple conversations. Next thing you know, boom. A guy by the name of Patrick McDavid returns my direct message to him on Facebook, which is in my book, In Faith Made Millionaire. And that was a God moment based on God's timing. There's a timing for success, wealth, prosperity, happiness, and joy. And here's what God does. He's testing us, which leads me to my final point. When things aren't going your way, are you looking for the optimism in the situation or are you looking for the cynicism in the situation? Because I think as I read Ecclesiastes chapter 3, I see King Solomon, the richest and wisest king who ever lived, actually be cynical. Again, my opinion, I could be wrong. Let's take a look at verse 18 through 21 here in chapter 3. It reads like that. I said to myself, as for humans, God tests them so that they may see that they are like the animals. Surely the fate of human beings is like that of the animals. The same fate awaits them both. As one dies, so dies the other. All have the same breath. Humans have no advantage over animals. Everything is meaningless. All go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return. Who knows if the human spirit rises upward, if the spirit of the animal goes down into the earth? King Solomon, very skeptical, very upset in his writings. Because I'm looking at this thing, he is so mad about what's going on right now. How many times have you been mad at God? How many times have you wrestled with God? I've wrestled with God many times. I was just wrestling with God the other day. There's times in our life that we don't agree with what's going on in our life. You wrestle, you're pissed off, you're doing all these different things. The harsh part about all that is being able to say, you know what, God, in my prayer, I trust you, I honor you. I don't know what's going on here, but God, you're gonna bless me in a mighty and powerful way. I trust that it's based on your timing in Jesus' name, right? Amen. And so when you look at that area of your life, you can't compare yourself to the people to the left or right. You can't compare yourself to people who are graduating. I'm looking at this presidential candidate right now, Vivek Ramaswamy. Look at this guy, the first millennial ever to run for president. He's 37 years old. He's being challenged left and right. And I'm watching this guy. I'm looking after video after video after video, the wisdom that is coming out with this guy. And I'm like, wow, this guy, could he be? Could he be one of those once in a generation type of leaders? I've seen a couple of them in my lifetime, and potentially this may be one of them. Why? Because I'm seeing this guy in multiple different formats, podcasts, mainstream media, answer many different questions. And he says, instead of the other candidates having you run away from things, he's uniting America to help Americans run to things, which is a clear picture of a more perfect union should be here in the United States of America. And I'm listening to this. This guy ain't 37 years old. He's speaking with the wisdom of a 57 year old, a 67 year old guy. But that's what I'm talking about. There's a time for everything. You can't compare yourself to a guy like that, but this guy is showing him to be a leader. And who knows? We'll see what he's all about in the GOP debate stage. I'm watching everybody right now because I'm praying for our leaders. The Bible commands us to pray for the leaders, even though you don't agree with them. And in God's timing, according to scripture, that all things work out for those that love the Lord. That's my prayer. That's what I trust God with. If there's anything I'm going to trust God with, I'm going to trust him with that. Animals can't do that. King Solomon, stop being cynical. Anyway, I'm looking forward to a long conversation in heaven with King Solomon, one of my heroes of the Bible, since he led the people of Israel to a 40-year golden age of wealth, wisdom, prosperity, where even the Queen of Sheba says, whoa, all the things that have been talked about all over the world, I only heard half of what you really are and the people around you. If you look at 1 Kings, I believe it's chapter 10, that even the Queen of Sheba was impressed by how the people around King Solomon was happy. And that's my prayer for you, that you go out there, you do your thing, you trust God, and God's gonna put you based on His timing to have a success pattern so that for everybody around you is blessed. If you read any of John Maxwell's books, and I suggest you do, he talks about this as the law of timing. The thing is, you and I, we don't get to control timing. We don't get to control when God puts things in our life. What we can do is to be ready for them. It's to be ready for opportunities, be mentally prepared, have your skills up to speed, have your business prepared, have your website up, have your business ready to go to accept the orders, have your infrastructure set up, have the right people in place. So therefore, when doors open up to you, again, only the doors that God can open comes open and floods you with blessings. Now you're ready to accept those blessings because you're ready for the timing, whether you're 10 years old or 20 years old or 50 years old or 80 years old. You're ready for the blessings that God has for you based, again, on His timing. In the meantime, get ready. If you're watching this right now and that's you, put in the comment section below, I am getting ready. And remember, your alignment with God will determine your assignment. The closer aligned you are, the greater and immediate that assignment will be. That's my prayer to you, because I've seen so many people have great alignment in life, and God says, no, I can trust this son, this daughter, with the least. And now they've trusted with the least because they've been aligned with me. Boom, now I can trust them with the most. And that's you, if that is your choice to be more and further aligned with God's word and His timing. And I encourage you to continue a deep dive, not just to take my word for it. Find your conversation with God as you dive into the word yourself. If you want to check out some of the episodes we've done here, breaking down the other Proverbs 1 through 31 in the first two, three chapters of Ecclesiastes, please click right here. From Dallas, Texas, I'm your Money Smart Guy. And until we meet again, continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be money smart today.